Good morning and welcome to Equivis Church. How awesome it is to gather together again. Whether you're in the third theater or you're at home or you're at any one of our church locations, come on, man, let's go. Let's gather together. Let's worship. Woo!
I throw my hands to the sky because I feel so alive and
good gathering together at the church, just to gather together and give him praise. Yeah. Give him praise for everything we've been through. Give him praise for how faithful he's been throughout this whole season. Yeah. Man, it's so good to be, whether you're in the theater and you're at church or you're at home, let's just remember, we're coming into the presence as his body of our amazing, trustworthy God. He's been faithful through this whole time. As we enter into worship, man, let's lift him up like we know he's trustworthy. We've seen him do it before. We'll see him do it again. So many miracles in his hands. Come on, let's worship.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. But you have never failed me. Change to come.
knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Jesus. Come on, sing this out this morning.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet.
No, you've never ever failed me, Father. Come on, sing this with us.
I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass.
My heart will say,
my heart will sing your praise again.
'Cause Jesus, you're still enough.
Jesus, you're still enough.
You've never failed me yet. Come on, that's a God we serve. That's a God we worship this morning. He is a God who is faithful to his promises, faithful to his word. So right where you are this morning, come on, in your homes, other locations, in this theater right here, why don't you just reach out to him? Reach out to him in confidence. He's the God who is faithful, who never lets us go, never lets us down. He's never failed us and he never will. Come on, worship your God this morning.
There's nothing better. Come on, wherever you are right now, how about lifting your hands? Because we believe the presence of God is with you right now. In fact, the Bible says wherever two or three are gathered in His name, there He is in the midst. We believe He wants to come and minister into your life, into your heart. Here's the good news. It doesn't matter what you're facing. You can know God in the middle of your circumstance. And I know for some people right now, there's a lot of challenges ahead. But the good news is God doesn't need to calm the storm for you to have peace. He can give you peace in the storm. Yeah. And we as a church love to pray and believe that God could work miracles in people's lives. So whatever you're going through, whatever you're up against, maybe you got something that you're believing for a breakthrough in, how about just lifting your hand to God? And if you're with some people in your room or in a theater or in a church building, just lift your hand because we're going to come into agreement and believe that God could do a miracle on your behalf. So come on, let's pray together, church. Let's believe together that God's going to move mountains, that God's going to make a way where in the natural there may be no way. So God, we come to you today, Lord, and we put our trust in you. We thank you, you are the author and the finisher of our faith. And today we're asking you to move mountains. We're asking you to break through on people's behalf. Lord, where people need healing, I pray your healing power would come and minister into people's lives. Lord, where people are needing, Lord, a breakthrough when it comes to jobs and provision. Lord, I thank you, you supply all our need according to your riches and glory. And today we can come to you, Lord, knowing that you hear our prayer and that you want to answer us in our time of need. Lord, today we give you honor and we give you praise. Lord, in this place, in Jesus' name we pray. And everyone all around said, amen, amen, amen. Well, a big welcome to Equippers Church. It's great that you've joined us. Wherever you're tuning in from, we've got people today in church buildings with gatherings up to 100. We've got people in theaters, and we've got people still meeting in homes, having house parties. And so church is happening all over the place. We've been able to move from 10 gatherings of 10 to now gatherings of 100, which is exciting. And I pray wherever you are, whoever you're with, this is going to be a powerful time where God's going to minister to you. Because it is, get this, it is Pentecost Sunday. We're celebrating the birth of the church. And, you know, the Holy Spirit came and many years ago, but He's present here today. And we'd love to extend a massive welcome to those who are tuning in for the first time to Equippers Church, or maybe you're in a gathering for the first time. You're loved in this place. We'd love to welcome you here. And we're a group of people who love Jesus and want to express that love to other people as well. So we're so glad you joined us. And we'd love to connect. In fact, if you're tuning in, you can click the link that's coming up on the chat there, and that just enables us to get in touch with you. But maybe you're in one of our locations in a church building or a theater. If you're visiting, we've got a gift for you. We'd love to give you some chocolate. So if you put your hand in the air and raise it, we've got some people who just come running down the aisle, and they'll put some chocolate into your hand. We'd just like to bless you. Love to see if there's any way that we can help you connect into the heart of who we are. So great to have you here. Come on, everyone, everywhere, let's put our hands together and give all the visitors a big welcome right now. Well, we are in level 2 and we can meet in bigger gatherings, which is exciting. And we're going to be working out how we can put on more gatherings of 100 people. But if you're in a location where Equippers isn't, don't worry, we're still going to be streaming into your home. And so you can be part of those gatherings, and maybe you just want to invite some friends to come along and join in with what God's doing as well. And I know that's happening already. Many houses have got house parties going on, and I hope you got food there, because church should be one big celebration. And we're just so glad wherever you are that you joined in. But hey, a few things that we've got, some big announcements that we need to let you know of. One announcement. The first one is that we need to let you know of is we're launching a new location. Woo! That's exciting. We've got locations all over the world. We've got 21 here in New Zealand. And we're launching a brand new one. And guess where this location is? It's online. Yes, that's right. It's online. We're launching an online location. And this is not just for people who are streaming in, who can't make it to a church building on Sunday. This is for people where we don't currently have an Equippers church. We're saying, hey, in this season, many people are connecting in e-groups online. And we're going to create an environment where people can experience church, the fullness of church, community online. And so that's going to happen for people right around New Zealand, but also right around the world. We've had many people move cities, move towns, and they haven't settled in a church. Don't worry, you still can be part of Equippers, and you can be a part of Equippers online. And so stay tuned. In fact, you can sign up if you want to find out more details about that. Maybe you are streaming in from overseas right now and you've loved what's going on and say, man, I want to be part of that community. Please go to the link below and sign up for Church Online. So we're going to be letting you know more details in the coming weeks. Hey, the other big announcement that we have for you is this year, we are still running Shout. Shout 2020 is happening. In fact, I really felt God speak to me through a passage found in Exodus chapter 14, verse 14. And it talks about the Israelites were in a place where the Red Sea was in front of them and the army was behind them. And they were trapped in a way. And God said to them, hey, I'm with you. I'm going to fight for you. Just stay calm. Just stay calm. I'm going to fight for you. And then the Lord said to Moses, why are you crying out? Tell the people to get moving. I really feel like a word for the church right now is for the church to keep on moving. And we're believing God's going to move obstacles in the way so that we can meet in a big gathering. And so we're pressing on, we're moving forward. And so Shout 2020 is happening. We're calling it Move. Because this is a movement, and I believe God's going to move in a sovereign way. So you want to be part of that. And so look out online. You can register. The only disclaimer is it won't take place if the government doesn't allow us. So that's the only disclaimer. But I believe God's going to make a way, and it's going to be one massive party. So that's taking place. That's going to take place from the 9th of July right through to the 11th of July. And so put that in the diary and let's be part of Shout 2020. Isn't that exciting news? That's great news right there. Pentecost Sunday, we're birthing new things. We're moving forward in Jesus' name. Hey, the other thing I just want to encourage you in is just in our giving. And I love the fact that and Paul talks about in 2 Corinthians chapter 9 that he's able to make all grace abound towards us. Another way of saying that is you and I are the target of His grace. And it says He's able to make all grace abound to us that we might have all sufficiency in all things. I'm really believing during this time that there'll be no lack, that people wouldn't live with need. God would come and He would supply all your need according to His riches and glory. That there'll be no lack, there'll be sufficiency in all things. But not only that, there'll be an abundance for every good work. You know, I believe this is a time for the church to be a blessing to the world around us, but we can't be a blessing unless we're first blessed. And God's grace, we're the target of God's grace, He blesses us so that we can be a blessing to others. And so I want to encourage you in your giving and your honoring of God. Come on, let's keep honoring Him, but let's believe that we're going to see an abundance in every place, that there's going to come the supply of heaven, you know, in people's lives. That where they won't just have their needs met, but there'll be an abundance for the good work that He's called us to. So can we pray right now? I want to pray over every household, over every life, that in this season, God's supply would be evident in Jesus' name. Let's pray together. Jesus, we thank You, Lord, that You are Lord of all. You are sovereign. And I thank You, Lord, we can come to You and we can present our need, knowing, Lord, that You hear us and You want to answer us. I pray that You'd answer people in a powerful way. Lord, that they'd know supernatural supply, that they'd know supernatural provision. Lord, that You'd enable the church at this time not just to be blessed, but to be a blessing to the world around. And we pray for your favor and your goodness to be on display. In Jesus' name we pray. And we said, amen, amen, amen. Well, it is Pentecost Sunday, and we thought we'd do something special. So today, we have Pastor Russell Evans with us. Well, he's not here in New Zealand. He's in Melbourne, but he's going to be speaking and ministering a powerful word to us. He's from Planet Shakers Church. Planet Shakers is connected strongly to us, and we love Pastor Russell and Sam Evans. They're just powerful ministers of the gospel. They're shaking the planet in many different places through their music, through their leadership, through the ministry there. And I believe your life is going to be touched today. So wherever you are, in whatever location, we're a responsive church. Let's respond to the word of God, and let's all welcome Pastor Russell Evans in as he comes to minister the word of God today. Here we go.
Kia ora, Equippers Church. It's so great to be with you this Sunday, Pentecost Sunday, where we celebrate two things, really. The coming of the Holy Spirit upon God's people, and also the birth of the church. In Acts chapter 2, we see that 120 were there, and really they were getting themselves ready for what Jesus had talked about, and the Holy Spirit came to give great power to his people. You know, I just want to say hello to Pastor Sam and Kathy and the whole team there at Equippers Church. You guys are amazing, and God is using you effectively all over the world. And I just believe the greatest days of Equippers are ahead as the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And today, I want you to open up your heart and open up your spirit to see what God wants to do in your life, in this season, in this time. I want to speak to you on the topic, God's glorious church. You know, there's an old nursery rhyme that we talked about when we're growing up, and we learned, you know, Humpty Dumpty. No, the nursery rhyme, Humpty Dumpty. The Bible, not the Bible, the nursery rhyme goes, Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. Then it says, all the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty together again. And I heard a guy talk about this, and he said, the reason why Humpty Dumpty couldn't be put back together again is because there was no mention of God's church, because all the king's horses may talk about all the institutions that people rely on. They will never put your life back together again. It's God through his church that will bring restoration and healing and revelation and power to this world. I heard someone once say, where the church goes, so does society. And God's church is God's institution at this time, or from the day of Pentecost. Jesus talked about the church first time in Matthew 16. Jesus was there, and the Bible says when he came, verse 13, into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I am? Who the Son of Man is? So they said, some say John the Baptist. So they were really telling him what the community understanding of him was. Some say Elijah, others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And then he turns it back to the disciples and he said to them, but who do you say that I am? Who do you say that Jesus is, Equippers? You know, in times where everything is flourishing, we can have a view of what Jesus is like. But in times where things are locked down and things are challenging in our lives, who is Jesus to you in this season? Who do you say that Jesus is? And the Bible says, and Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. In other words, man's reasoning has not revealed this to you, but it's a supernatural revelation from my Father that's revealed it to you. And he says, and you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. The very first time church is mentioned in the Bible. In Acts chapter 2 is when the church is launched. In Matthew 16 the church is introduced. And he then says, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Wow, God's institution to bring kingdom reformation. And Acts chapter 2, there they are on the day of Pentecost, in one accord, one mind, and then suddenly from heaven came the sound of a mighty rushing wind. And all of a sudden, Peter, who was timid, becomes Peter, who says, "You who crucified Christ." There was an encounter and an empowerment for the church, the vehicle, God's institution, to bring change in society and to bring his kingdom into this earth. Who is Jesus to you? You know, Peter stood up, and I actually believe he was standing up on behalf of all the disciples, and he was telling them what they thought Jesus was. And he said, "You are the Christ, the anointed one." He is the Christ. The word Christ means anointed. And you see, if you don't understand, Jesus is the anointed one, you'll never operate in the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit, because we'll just be operating in a practical, man-made Christianity. But God wants a supernatural, empowered Christianity, a spirit-empowered Christianity. You know, Jesus, when he came off the mountain for fasting for 40 days, he then announces himself to the world. And he goes into the temple and he opens a scroll in Luke 4, and it says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me." Everyone say, "Anointed me." In your house, say, "He's anointed me." He's anointed me to what? To preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. There are so many brokenhearted people right now. There's so many people who are going through challenges right now, and it's needing God's church empowered by the Spirit of God to rise up. It's to proclaim liberty to the captives. So many people feeling captive right now, and recovery of sight to the blind. In other words, vision wants to come to your life. God doesn't want you to live in darkness. He wants to turn the light on and bring direction where there seems no direction. Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall. He had a great fall, but all the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty together again. In other words, all the institutions we might depend upon will never give you vision. What gives you vision is understanding who Christ is. He's the anointed one. And the same anointing that was on Jesus is on you and I, his glorious church, to bring change and reformation. Anointing means to be set apart for a divine purpose or purposes. You are set apart for a divine purpose, Equippers Church. You are set apart to bring change all over the world, in all the continents that you're in. You are set apart to bring the love of Jesus. You're set apart to bring the power of Jesus. You're set apart to bring heaven's wisdom. You're set apart to bring heaven to earth through your life. Who is Christ to you? Who is Jesus to you? Is he just a teacher? Is he just a philosopher? Or is he the anointed one? It's because the anointing is what changes people. You see, the anointing brings healing. God wants to use his church to bring healing to people's lives, whether it's physically, emotionally, whether it's spiritually. God wants us to operate in the anointing, and we receive the anointing when the Holy Spirit comes upon us. In Acts 2, the Holy Spirit came upon them and gave them power, ability, efficiency, and might. He anointed them, set them apart to bring healing to the world. The anointing is for proclaiming liberty. It's time to declare there is life in Jesus. The devil comes to steal, to kill and destroy. That's what a virus will do. Steal, kill and destroy. Destroy from people's economies, destroy from their health. But Jesus came to proclaim liberty. He came to bring liberation to people. He came to set and proclaim liberty. You know, it's our finest hour, church, when we declare that Jesus is the liberator of all people. He is the one who sets us free. He came, the anointing is for the recovery of sight to the blind. I talk about this. It's a recovery of vision. So many people not knowing what the next day is going to bring, what the next season is going to bring. But the Holy Spirit is the one who brings revelation. He is our advocate. He is the one who comes alongside. He is the one who leads us into all truth. The Holy Spirit is here for you and I. In fact, Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he said in John 16, I'm going away, but I'm going to send somebody who will represent me and he'll lead you into all truth. He's called the Holy Spirit. You see, vision is led by truth and truth leads vision. When you understand who Jesus is, the truth of who he is, you have great vision for your life. And my encouragement to you, Equippers, today is let the Holy Spirit come and illuminate and bring vision to what he wants you to do in this season. The anointing was to bring liberty or liberation of the oppressed. So many oppressed right now. So many discouraged right now. So many people hurting right now. And the anointing is there on you and I, the church, God's glorious church, to bring liberation to the oppressed. And also to proclaim the year of the Lord. It is not time to shrink back. It's not time to bunker down. It's time to outreach, Equippers. It's time for the church to outreach to lost and hurting people, to ring somebody, to encourage somebody, to buy something for somebody, to share a link of church to somebody, to do something. Don't live according to your cocoon, but get out of your cocoon and look according to the vision God has for your life. To proclaim the year of the Lord. So he said, you're the Christ. The second thing he said is, you're the Son of the living God. I love this because we don't serve a dead God who's not interested in our life. We serve a God who's alive. We serve a God who comes to give life and life to the full. We serve a God who gives Zoe life. He comes and empowers us to make a difference. Acts 1:8, you receive power. Power brings life. And God wants our life to be living, spiritually active. He hasn't called us to be locked in confinement. He's designed you to be living, to be active. And you know, there's this word called atrophy, which actually what happens is if people do not, it actually means this, a wasting away of a body or an organ, a degeneration or a decline or a decrease from disuse, not use. And you know the thing we got to be careful with right now in this world, that we don't, we start disusing or stop using our spiritual muscles. I want to encourage you, if you're watching online, don't just turn up in your pajamas and sit there with a coffee and go, yeah, bro, that's good, bro. In praise and worship, just don't sit there and chill out. Stand on your feet. Get your spiritual muscles active. You know, yes and amen. Let there be a shout of victory in the house of God. If you got family around you, lay hands upon them in your families. Get your spiritual massive activated. It's a living God. He's not a dead God. He's alive. And it's time for, we don't need any spiritual atrophy in the body of Christ. We need the body of Christ moving and ministering and touching lives for his glory. He's a living God. He's alive. Ephesians 2, 1 to 10 says, and you he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sin, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience, among whom also we also conducted ourselves in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the others. But God, who is rich in mercy, I love this. A God that's dead doesn't have mercy because he doesn't have the ability to have it. But a God who's live brings mercy, rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made alive together with Christ. By grace we have been saved and raised up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you've been saved through faith. It's not of yourself, it's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. In other words, our good works should be backed up by the living God. In other words, we have grace, unmerited favor from this living, loving, powerful God. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then Jesus says, blessed are you, Peter. Peter is the word Petros, and a masculine form of the word for a stone. So in other words, Petros is a stone. But the word rock that Jesus has used here is Petra, which is a feminine form of the same word. This word was used in classical Greek for a collection of stones knitted together to form a larger rock, such as a ledge or a slab. It meant many stones joined together to form a rock that is far larger and more significant than one stone could be. This is a great picture of the church. Elsewhere, Paul likened it to the human body, in which all individual parts are knit together to form one whole. The analogy is different, but the point is the same. The church is not built on Peter alone, but on Peter, the apostles, and all those who believe and confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, coming together to form this larger entity called the church. So it's your revelation and my revelation and Peter's revelation and Sam's revelation and Bruce's revelation and every one of the people all over the world's revelation of who Jesus is. He is the Christ, and it's on the revelation of who Jesus is the stones come together to form a rock of revelation. The body comes together and operates with Christ as the head. So, who is Christ to you? You need your own personal revelation of who he is. You know the Holy Spirit. The Bible says, flesh and blood have not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. In other words, heavenly revelation comes from the Godhead. And the Holy Spirit is the third member of the Trinity, is active in the world today. And his whole job is to reveal who Jesus is, and Jesus reveals the Father. And so the revelation of Jesus comes through the illumination of the Holy Spirit of who Jesus is. That's why Pentecost Sunday, our celebrating Pentecost, is so important, because it's the Holy Spirit who reveals, who is our advocate, and he is the one that reveals Jesus. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. So God's glorious church is built on the revelation of Christ. He is the foundation of the rock that we live our lives on. God's glorious church is a church that's alive. God's glorious church is built on the anointing. But watch this. God's vehicle is the church. It's the church for transformation to New Zealand, to Australia, to Geneva, to there in Rio de Janeiro, to Sao Paulo, to India, to the UK. You're going over there in the UK. To every one of you in Germany, to there in New Zealand, to my relatives, now that my daughter's married, I'm part Maori, Kiora. But God's vehicle is the church to bring transformation. Do you know the word church means called out ones? You have been called out by God to bring heaven to earth through your life. God's calling you, Equippers Church, to make a difference in the world like never before. God's calling you and saying, come on, let's go change the world together. God's calling you. You know when Jesus says, I'm going away and you'll do even greater than I do? How could we do greater than Jesus? Jesus wasn't talking about the quality of miracle. You know, you can't get better than raise a dead man who's dead back to life. It's pretty hard to beat 5 loaves and 2 fish feeding at least 20, 30,000 people. So how can you do greater in the quality of miracle? He wasn't saying about that. We will have the quality of miracles. But what he's saying is we'll do greater because every one of us will have the Spirit of God. Every one of us will have the Holy Spirit come upon us if we want Him to give us ability, efficiency and might to use greatly for Him. Every one of us, so we can change the world in a greater sphere at one time. That's how we can do greater, even greater, is when the Spirit of God, the purpose of the church, we're called out to do great things for God. We're called out to do to see the world change in a time where there's a pandemic, where there's issues, where there's problems. It's a time for the called out ones to begin to bring change, whether it's through prayer, whether it's through good deeds, whether through miracles, whether it's being a light, where there's darkness. You're called out. You are the vehicle for transformation. What is the purpose of the church? It's for the exaltation of Jesus. We don't lift up a name of a church. We don't lift up a name of a preacher because none of them will save you. But we lift up a name that's above every name. The reason why we come together and we worship is to exalt Jesus. The reason we want to bring transformation is to exalt Jesus. Everything we do is for the exaltation of Jesus. It's not for the exaltation of any man. It's for the exaltation of Jesus. That's the purpose of our churches. The purpose of the church is for the proclamation of the gospel. We're being called out to proclaim the good news. There's good news in Jesus. He is a healer. He is our joy. He is our peace. He is our love. He is our protection. He is the banner over us. He is our provider. It's for the proclamation of good news. The purpose of the church is for biblical doctrine. Amazes me how many people live by humanistic thinking rather than what the Word of God says. It's the Word of God that we base our life on. We don't base it on human reasoning. We don't base it on, you know, what institutions will say. Yes, we have wisdom with all that, but we base our life on the Word of God says. What does the Word of God say about your life and my life? What does the Word of God say about our families? As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. What does the Bible say about provision? What does the Bible say about the church? What does the Bible say about everything we do? That's what we base our lives on. The Word of God, biblical doctrine. That's what the church was established to help. What is the church's purpose? Providing a place of fellowship. A place, you know, as good as online and reaching people, it's all good. And you know, at Planet Shakers, we probably reach 500,000 people every week online. But online is a church experience. Online isn't church. It's just what we're using right now to have a church experience. What is church is fellowship and discipleship. It is the fellowship of coming together. And I want to encourage you, don't get in your spiritual atrophy, but get your spiritual muscles ready, because there will be a time where we can come together in greater and greater numbers. Pray that it happens. Coming together, place of fellowship, the joining of meals, the breaking of bread, that's family. God has a purpose for His church to be family. The purpose of His church is prayer and intimacy with God. The purpose of church is lighthouse, to be a lighthouse where there's darkness. It's to be salt in our community. It is the kingdom representation of heaven on earth. I've taught this for many, many years. The Bible says we're ambassadors of God. What does that mean? We have all of the kingdom we represent at our disposal. And an ambassador lives in an embassy. So if I went to New Zealand and went into the Australian embassy, or went to Germany in the Australian embassy, as I step into those places, I'm in Australia. When people step into your vicinity, you are the church. The church isn't a building. The church it's the people of God coming together with the purpose of lifting up Jesus. But when they come into your vicinity, they should be stepping into heaven, because you carry heaven in your life. We are the kingdom representative of heaven on earth. It's for discipleship. The church is a body. It's supposed to function together. Bible says each joint supplies. We supply to each other, connected. That's why don't get dislocated at this time. Get located. Come together. The church is a body. The church is a family, as I said before. The church's purpose is a hospital to heal the broken. The church's purpose is be a bride. Think about this. Lucifer was the most beautiful angel out of all of them. And he got prideful. And you see two beauties on this earth right now. You see the beauty of the flesh that gets exalted all through media and Hollywood, and where people say that's what's beautiful. But that is how Satan views beauty. But God's beauty is in his church, the bride, the glory of heaven. And God says, you thought you were beautiful? Watch what I do. I'm going to raise up a bride that is more beautiful than you ever were, that is more dynamic and more powerful. And I actually made them lower than you, Lucifer, but they're going to have greater beauty because they're going to reflect my glory. Your beauty reflects your pride. Their beauty will reflect my glory. We are the bride to reflect the glory of God. And we are an army. It's time to stand up in our prayer lives. The Bible says heaven suffers violent and the violent take it by force. In other words, there's a determination in faith that say, God, you've got to shift something in our nation. God, you've got to shift something in the world. God, we bind any spirit that would try to control and intimidate and manipulate. We bind any spirit that is not of you, and we loose. That's why the Bible says he gives you the keys of the kingdom. We are the army of God. We are the army of God. And the Bible says that on this rock I'll build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail. So there is a spiritual battle, but he says, I'll give you the keys of the kingdom. In other words, whatever the enemy throws at you, whatever attack, I'll give you a key to lock, to bind what they're doing, and I'll get you a key to open up heaven to be a answer to that situation. I'll give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. God has given us keys, church, in prayer. We can come into agreement with what the heavenly realms say, what God says in the heavenly realms, and we can bind in the heavenly realms what the enemy wants to do. I'll give you the keys of the kingdom. We are an army. Ephesians 6 talks about putting on the armor of God. Check it out in your own time. And you know, I hear a lot of people talking about the new norm. Let me tell you what I believe the church's role is in the new norm. It's to bring a heavenly norm, not an earthly norm, a heavenly norm. That should be the new norm. You know, you see, we're called to bind all things that aren't of Christ and loose all things which are in what heaven is like on earth. That's what you and I are. And you know, the church is God's vehicle for restoration, transformation, and it's the Holy Spirit that comes in the church to bring change. That's why on this Pentecost Sunday, we honor Holy Spirit. Wherever you are, come on. Reach out to Him. God's called you to be His church. You are the Christ, the Anointed One. You are the Son of the living God. You're alive. on the revelation of these stones coming together, form a ledge, a rock. I'll build my church. That will shift things in the spirit. The gates of hell will not prevail. And this church will be powerful to bring transformation because it has the power to bind and to loose. Come together in agreement. And that's the Holy Spirit that gives us power to do that. So if you're in your room, would you stand to your feet wherever you are? If you're wherever you are, would you honor Him by positioning yourself to receive from Him so you can be the glorious church God called you to be, called us to be? The church isn't a denomination. The church is the global body of kingdom people being a vehicle for revival and breakthrough and restoration and transformation. But it's the Holy Spirit that comes upon ordinary people and makes them extraordinary, that comes and takes broken people and makes them trophies of grace, that turns us from sinners to saints. We're no longer saint. We're not sinners saved by grace after you get saved. We're now saints that sometimes mess up, but we're saints because we're positioned with Christ Jesus in heavenly places. You are called and anointed for this time, for such a time as this. But it's the Holy Spirit that comes upon us. Would you worship? Would you lift your hands, Tim, wherever you are? And would you say this after me? Holy Spirit, come upon me. I need you right now. Reveal Jesus to me. Holy Spirit, if there's anything in my heart that is stealing from my peace, you take it away and you bring peace. Holy Spirit, would you empower me? Would you fill me from the top of my head to the tips of my toes? Would you fill me with your anointing and your glory? Jesus, you're the Christ, the anointed one, and that same Spirit that raised you from the dead lives in me. So would you come upon us right now to be witnesses in Auckland, in Dunedin, Wellington, in New Zealand, in Australia, in Asia, in Europe, South America, in North America. You are the Christ in the islands, in Tonga, Pacific Islands. You are the Christ. Come upon us, Holy Spirit. Fill us with your glory. Fill us with your anointing. Let your power and your presence come upon your people right now. I know I've said this before, but every morning my grandfather would get up, he would lift his hands to heaven, and he would say, I honor you, Holy Spirit. I receive you today. And he would take a deep breath of faith, an act of faith, saying, I recognize you're here. Just like I have normal breath, you are the breath that I live and breathe in. You are the one who empowers me. So would you do that with me right now? Just receive. Just take that deep breath. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. I receive you, Holy Spirit. And you receive power. In a moment, the worship team's going to come and we're going to worship God. But His power and His presence is here for you right now. Would you step into His presence? Would you honor Him? Would you receive from Him? Right here, right now, I break, I bind anything the enemy would try to do over your life. We join our faith together and we bind it. And now we loose favor and blessing and healing and breakthrough and jobs and provision. We loose the blessing of God. We thank you for it, Lord. In the name of Jesus, the worship team's going to take over. One of the hosts is going to come back too. I want to tell you, Equippers Church, God has a glorious church and you're a part of it. And He wants to use you. It's time to arise. It's time to shine. For your light has come and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. I want to tell you how much we love you. God loves you even more. We love your pastors, Pastor Sam and Kathy and the whole team. And God's greatest days are ahead because God's glorious church is God's institution to bring restoration and transformation. Come on, let's worship Him. Worship team, you go for it. God bless you.
There is a holy fire.
What a powerful word that was this morning. I pray you're blessed by it. And I know the touch of the Holy Spirit is in every location. God's not bound by geographic boundaries. He can meet us right where we're at. And whether you got some things going on, the good news is the Holy Spirit, He's our counselor, He's our teacher, and He leads us into truth. And the feeling that we feel on the inside, we've sometimes just got to respond to that. And I've found when you respond to the Holy Spirit, God opens up new things in our lives. You know, there's a whole group of people here today who may be streaming in and you've never connected with Jesus in a personal, in a living way. Here's the thing, God's not dead, He's alive. And He wants to come and make Himself known through the power of the Holy Spirit today. And today, if you just open your heart to Him, if you believe that Jesus is your Lord and is your Savior, He'd come and forgive you of your sin, the sin that separates you from God. See, we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But the good news is Jesus died on the cross. He paid the price of our sins so that we might know God, that we might know eternal life. And there's something inside each and every one of us that says we're born for more. And the truth of the matter is we are. We're born for a relationship with Jesus. And right now, the Holy Spirit wants to make God's love known to you if you just open your heart to Him. So wherever you are, you may wish to pray this prayer along with me. God, today I come to you and I open the door of my heart. I ask you to come in and be my Lord and Savior. Today I ask for your forgiveness for my sin. Come live inside of me. Today I declare you are my Lord and Savior. We pray this in your name. Amen. Hey, if you just prayed that prayer, the good news is God is living in on the inside of you right now. And as a church, we'd love to join with you in your journey of trusting God. Because what church is simply a whole lot of friends challenging one another to go higher in God. So please don't leave the space you're in without telling somebody. Maybe you just want to click on the link there and get in touch with us. We'd love to support you in your journey of knowing God more. Wow, what a service that was. Incredible. I pray you're all blessed by it. Hey, just a few things to remind you of. We're launching online church. So if you're keen to be part of that and know of some people, please do sign up online there as well. Spread the word, get that out. Also, Shout coming up. That's taking place. Also, you want to tune in for our night service. We've got a special night service taking place. So come be a part of that. Other than that, just go online and find out what's happening in your location. Different centres are opening up in different venues. In Auckland, we've got theatres going. And other places where we've got church buildings, we're meeting in those church buildings up to the limit of 100. Hopefully, in the not-too-distant future, we'll be able to gather more. But to stay in touch, make sure you do go to our website and you can find out all the details there. Other than that, we're going to finish with a song of praise. So wherever you are, how about standing to your feet? Let's enter in together. Let's give God the highest praise. All right.
For Equippers at Home. To see how to give help and get help, head to equipperschurch.com/at home. You'll also find more information on getting connected, prayer, and giving in this season. God bless you. We'll see you next week.